evening and welcome to Tinkering with Etkelar. For this episode, I took out a random find from a flea market, a Palm IIIxe handheld. Well, it's been away from the public view for a few years, so I better tell the younger audience members what this is right after I polish it up. After taking the device apart for a deep clean, it is obvious that there is not much that might need fixing. There is one supercap on the PCB, which is used to keep the memory during battery changes. Yes, this still took two AAA batteries and ran on them for ages. It is a monochrome model after all. The color models started with built-in rechargeable batteries and sucked them dry within a day or two. The operating system and built-in applications would run from a ROM chip, while everything else was kept in RAM, hence the buffer capacitor. The device cleaned up nicely, so time to add some batteries and give it a try. That was uneventful and quick. So, what next? Oh, I found a matching docking station, the Cradle, on eBay. It seemed to be from a slightly different model, since the plastic color doesn't match, but the shape is exactly right, so it must have been at least the same overall series. It might be that the Cradle is already 3Com branded, while the Palm is still Palm Inc. branded. The Cradle also cleaned up nicely. What I thought was a rubbed-off button turned out to be grime. Yuck! Somebody used that for some time. And here's a bit of a history lesson for you young whippersnappers with your fruit phones and pocket robots. Palm Incorporated started off in the early to mid 90s as a company that made specifically this type of handheld devices, known as PDAs or Personal Digital Assistants, and called them Palm Pilot. They came with a calendar, to-do list, phone book, and note-taking app. For input, it uses a pen system called Graffiti. The lower part of the input area has this panel that specifically reacts to pen gestures, and the OS turns those into characters. It is similar to handwritten letters, but simplified, so it didn't have to do full text recognition and made writing proper text rather easy, quick, and much less error-prone than similar devices. Anybody eaten up Martha recently? I used the Palm for the longest time myself, starting with their very first model, the Palm Pilot 1000. I upgraded the ROM to the Palm 2 and then hopped over to the Palm 3C, which was the first one to introduce a color screen. I still can enter text into this system, much more reliable than using an on-screen touch keyboard on modern phones. Connectivity came in form of a program called HotSync. It ran on Windows and tied the serial port of the device together with your Outlook calendar, to-do entries, notes, and email messages. Synchronization was made easy with the Cradle that comes with a button to trigger the process. Since it synced incrementally, it only took seconds. Arrive at the office, click sync, and before you even had coffee, your device and Outlook were agreeing on your schedule for the day. No, sign up here, connect to cloud there, enter verification code over here, and grant access to your location or similar BS. Those were the days. Older similar devices, usually called organizers, had similar features but weren't as extensible. This one runs on Palm OS and allowed for custom apps. The development tools were initially only available on the Mac, because both use a 68K based processor, so compiling, debugging, and emulation was easier. Alas, all good things come to an end. Palm Incorporated was eventually gobbled up by US Robotics, which in turn was swallowed by 3Com. From there, innovation seemed to fizzle out eventually. Not least because Microsoft had their Windows CE devices and Apple launched the iPhone, both offering slightly more modern features and issues. The revision I have here is a Palm IIIxe, made around the year 2000, but still black and white for a display. It has 8 MB of memory, a 160x160 pixel black and white LCD display with a backlight, that tried, resistive touch input, a serial port in the custom connector, and an infrared port. Note that there is no radio stuff in there. Okay, here I am, ready to sync with Windows 95. Well, here's where this project turns into something more tinkering. I really would love to use this device with a more modern OS. I was already afraid I might need to code my own HotSync app, but some heavy digging on the internet led me to JPilot, a Linux-based HotSync alternative. Not 100% perfect, but at least this provides a way to install applications and backup the device. Plenty useful. After another round of research, I found a small community around the Palm OS devices that includes an also still active development branch. And here's where I got a working, open-sourced toolchain that compiles the proper Palm binaries with a modern GCC compiler. Sweet! It took a bit of poking and prodding, and I got the fatal error screen quite often. Sometimes it would even still react to the on-screen reset button. But eventually, I made a tiny Hello World style app that includes a working menu and alert box. I call that a successful start. The program flow is very similar to how a Windows program would work. There is a bit of startup code to detect how the program was launched. This provides integration with various system features, like the global search bar. Then there is an event loop that pulls an event, like pen down, from the queue and distributes it to various handling methods. Here's where I made the most mistakes. Seems that you have to handle quite a few events for the app to successfully run, especially when there are pop-ups like alerts involved. Palm OS also comes with a built-in database support to simplify typical PDA-style apps that provide some sort of data entry for records. Maybe I'll make myself an inventory app? So that's it about a piece of significant but already almost forgotten computing history. I hope you enjoyed this episode. See you next time! And here's a bit of a history lesson for you young whippersnappers and you... For you young... Yeah, that is hard to say. How do the old people do that?